The explosion happened at about 6:30 on Cracker Night. Eight teenage girls were standing on the Hunter District Water Board's underground reservoir, lighting firecrackers, when, according to the girls, there was a rumble from beneath them and they were blown into the air and then into the icy water. Investigations began immediately, but after repeated calls for an independent inquiry and more gas was found in the stormwater drains, the Minister for Industrial Relations, Pat Hills, directed his officers to undertake a technical study. Both seam and sewage gas was ruled out, and it was found that a relatively unlimited supply of pipe gas leaked freely from the almost non-existent service pipe and damaged the main. With its natural buoyancy in air, it flowed up the drainage system to the vent at the top of the reservoir, approximately 28 metres higher than the gas leak. The findings of the report have stirred action in Sydney to tighten up the controls on pipe gas. Officer in charge of the DIR in Newcastle, Mr Jim Cox.
The Minister and the Minister for Natural Resources, Mrs Crozio, and the Minister for Energy, Mr Cox, have met, and I attended the meeting. And it was decided after Cabinet discussions that the Gas and Electricity Act would be strengthened to give powers of inspection over gas reticulation systems. These powers will be similar to that which is in the Dangerous Goods Act that this department administers.
But why were the damaged pipes unchecked? Spokesman for New Gas, John Stretton.
Well, the damage to both the sections of pipe that's mentioned in the report were undetectable by normal means. They were both under tar-sealed roads and consequently couldn't be detected. And that's why the gas evidently was leaking into the stormwater drainage system.
Is New Gas willing to accept responsibility for the explosion?
No, the gas company is not prepared to accept responsibility for the explosion.
For the eight teenage girls involved in the explosion, the establishment of the cause of the blast is most welcome. But what action will they take now? Solicitor for 78 girls, John McFadden.
Our present course is to commence proceedings without delay. It seems that all of these children have suffered somewhat serious injuries, and it's yet to prove what the future for them will be.
A council investigation concluded that the costs involved in getting water from the Hunter River for domestic use would be far greater than bringing water 25 kilometres overland from the Glennys Creek Dam. According to Chief Engineer John Gould, not only will the water be of better quality, but with no need for a treatment plant, more than $2 million will be saved. Work on the pipeline and a chlorination plant will commence early next year and should be finished by mid-1987, at which time an exciting plan for turning Lake St Clair into a major recreational area will also be well on the way to fruition. The plan, which will be funded partly by the Singleton Shire Council and the Steel Industries Assistance Fund, includes Stage 1, a boat ramp at an inlet between two peninsulas, which the council expects to lease from the Water Resources Commission. Following Stage 1 will be a progressive improvement program, which will see the development of cabins, amenities blocks, sports areas, a heritage centre and a caravan park, which no doubt will be greatly used and appreciated by people throughout the Hunter.
The report says Mr. Lewis should be replaced, or a new position should be created with a reduced role and function, and that there should be a complete overhaul of senior staff. It seems to have laid the majority of the blame on Mr. Lewis, saying that he's made a series of rash, unauthorised and improper decisions. These include the supply of an electoral roll in computer tape form to the then Alderman Don Geddes, a form that was not sold before, and that he also failed to inform the council of the sale. The invoices were supplied by the staff, but the inspectors note, "We find it difficult to appreciate their certainty when they can remember almost nothing else of the circumstances." This, according to the report, was a classic example of what it describes as inadequate records. Another matter of concern raised in the report was the Deputy City Engineer, Mr Chapman's involvement with the often successful tenderer for council engineering projects. According to the report, despite Mr Chapman's attempts to make his superiors aware of his association, senior staff showed reluctance to comprehend the necessity for public officials to stay at arm's length at the risk of arousing suspicion of favouritism. For that and other reasons, the report recommends an overhaul of senior council staff. The report also says there were items of irregularity about the terms of employment of Civic Theatre's promotion executive Louis Van Eysen and the termination of employment of the Matara Festival organiser John Young. Mr Lewis refused to comment on the recommendation. Former Alderman Don Geddy says the report is political and Mr Lewis is being used as a scapegoat.
My total reaction is one of shock in relation to the town clerk, one of disgust that that's in fact occurred. It hurts me greatly to know that he's been sacked or been recommended for sacking. He doesn't deserve it. He has never deserved it. He's been a loyal member of the council. He's been a loyal friend to all the aldermen on the council, just not to me.
On the other side of the political fence, former Labor alderman Jeff Parker says the report is fair.
Well, Danielle, generally I'm happy. I think it's a conservative document, but on the whole I think it's a fair document.
The Minister for Local Government, Kevin Stewart, says he will set up a committee of local government officers and the administrator to discuss legislation changes to the Greater Newcastle Act, including the number of aldermen and the number of wards in the next Newcastle City Council. He says he'll be inviting comment from council officers and the public on these matters.
These days, smokers are outnumbered by non-smokers, and for the state government, raising the tax on cigarettes is a good way of raising revenue without paying the electoral consequences.
The budget raised the tobacco licence fee from 15 to 25%, which will add up to 13 cents to a packet of 20 cigarettes, and also increase the price of cigars and other tobacco. Not surprisingly, retailers are incensed by the move. Merv Atkins owns a tobacco store in Hunter Street and is also the president of the New South Wales Retail Traders Tobacco Association.
Well, it'll have a detrimental effect on New South Wales retailers. The increased tax will increase the price, reduce consumption, and it will also have the effect that New South Wales will be paying a higher tax than Canberra again. Canberra tax is 15%, whereas the New South Wales new tax will be 25%.
And how does that affect the retailers?
Well, it affects the retailers in Sydney dramatically, especially in the western suburbs, because cigarettes come in from Canberra to that area and are sold cheaper. The public are the winners, but the retailers find it very difficult to compete on a legitimate basis.
Mr. Atkins believes most smokers will accept the price rise without protest. The smokers I spoke to seemed resigned to the increase.
Well, if you want something, you've got to pay for it, haven't you?
So it doesn't worry you at all that the price has risen?
I'm going to give up.
You're going to give up? Why, it's getting too expensive?
Well, I said when it got to two, I'd give up. And it's getting close to two.
Newcastle and Hunter Valley people are recognised as a most travel-orientated population. For the third year in a row, Jays has set up this exhibit free of charge. About 30 tour operators from overseas and domestic destinations are taking part this year. As well as information stands and video displays, a small theatrette has been running non-stop, showing films of faraway and exotic places. The most popular holiday destination in Australia this year is the Northern Territory, although a great deal of interest is being shown in Western Australia with the upcoming America's Cup Challenge. Overseas, Europe remains a favourite in every age group. The show's open until 9:30 tonight.
The major events this weekend gets off tomorrow morning with the half marathon, the Lake Macquarie City half marathon, 21.2 kilometres, starting off in Spears Point Park and going around the foreshore to Valentine and back again. Then on Sunday, we've got our triathlon. More than 300 entries for the triathlon have been received so far. That's more than double what we had last year. We've got the major amateur athletics carnival on tomorrow, and we have a world-rated pole vaulter who'll be coming in and hopefully giving a demonstration. And then on Sunday, we've got the biggest little athletics carnival that's ever been held in the Hunter region.
Respect for Barry Lewis.
Although more than 12 months have lapsed since the computer tapes incident occurred, former Alderman Margaret Gumatz today said it was the main reason for her decision to part from Citizens Group.
I've decided to resign from Citizens Group because I'm not happy the way Citizens Group handled the tapes affair.
Has the leadership of the Citizens Group been of concern to you?
Well, the leadership of the Citizens Group concerned me because they had the tapes in their possession for some months before they disclosed this to the elected members and to the group at large.
Why have you chosen to resign now? After all, you've known all of this for some time, haven't you?
I've been very concerned with the events that happened at the City Hall last week, and I have chosen this time now to resign.
Would you stand again?
Yes, I will stand again, but only as an independent. I believe that politics should not be in local council, and I will only stand as an independent.
Do you think Barry Lewis has been the victim in all this?
Most definitely. I have the greatest respect for Barry Lewis. I feel that he's given his undivided devotion to both his position and to Newcastle, and it hurts me very much to see him suffering now.
Street at around 10 past 11 yesterday morning. Despite their efforts, it was too late to save an elderly woman who was found dead in the gutted lounge room. The woman is believed to be the only occupant of the house. The police are still carrying out investigations into her positive identification. The lounge room was severely damaged by the blaze. However, the remainder of the house suffered only minor fire, smoke and water damage. The cause of the blaze is still unknown. Police will today continue their inquiries.
Mr. Lewis decided to tell his side of the story because he says he's been silent for long enough. He says the recommendation to have him removed as town clerk is unjustified, and at no time did he mislead the council over the supply of an electoral roll in computer tape form to Alderman Geddes.
I have not misled the council on the tape issue nor any other issue.
But you did finally admit that that you had supplied the tape.
I indicated to the council that I had authorised the supply of the tape, but at no time did I mislead the council.
And he remains resolute that he will not resign.
Will you resign as a result of this recommendation to have you removed?
Definitely not.
Will you stay in council then if you are removed?
I think that's further down the track than we all imagine, and I have confidence that that event will not take place.
Mr. Lewis is preparing a report on the allegations for the administrator, and he's seeking the advice of a QC on the course he should pursue. Meanwhile, former Lord Mayor Joy Cummings has made her first public comment on the controversy since she suffered a stroke 18 months ago. She says she endorses the local government inspector's recommendation to have Mr. Lewis removed from his position as town clerk. Mrs. Cummings says she requested an investigation into the council's administration 4 weeks before she became ill because of the tense issue and other matters of concern. She says the most recent report confirms her fears. Before her disabling stroke in April last year, Mrs. Cummings says she was seeking to have Mr. Lewis sacked, and she believes the inspector's recommendation would have been made if she was still Lord Mayor and the council had not been dismissed.
So you believe the administrator really should ask him to step down?
Yes.
Thank you.
For the members of the Closter Ford Syndicate, last night's lotto draw of the numbers 32, 12, 3, 7, 35, 10 and a supplementary of 2 gave them a share in a first division prize of $2 million. They were among four winners last night, giving them in excess of $500,000 in prize money. Today it was back to work for all the syndicate members, and not surprisingly, the champagne flowed. For syndicate organiser Wayne McCary, the win is still hard to believe.
Oh my word, it's not something you expect to do twice in a lifetime. And it's we're starting to come down to realisation now that of the sort of money that's involved.
The syndicate has been together since January this year and has stuck with the same numbers selected at random by Wayne's wife. The members of the syndicate range from the general manager at Closter's through to a worker in their spare parts department. All have different ideas about what they'll do with their $40,000 share of the money. The win takes the total winnings in the Lower Hunter to over $30 million since Lotto began 6 years ago.
Get into it, mate.
Coincidentally, Closter Ford began a joint promotion with Lotto yesterday for Lotto's sixth birthday in November. The syndicate joked that it might be an omen.
We've won a few minor prizes, but it's nice to have a big one.
As with most of the other experts who have travelled from around the world to be at the symposium, Professor Epstein is involved with research into preventing cardiovascular disease. He says they all agree that stress, a high cholesterol diet, smoking and obesity are all contributing factors to heart disease. But he believes it can be avoided if you begin early enough.
In youth, early in life, in the family, at the time children go to school, teenage, because for two reasons, early in life, habits are formed. It's very, very difficult to stop smoking once you've started it, to lose weight once you're overweight, and so on. Habits are formed in youth. This is one reason. The other reason is that actually the pathological changes, the disease itself, I mean the changes in the heart and in the blood vessels, start in youth. And this is when one has to start preventing it.
This is the second year the combined art exhibition has been held. 16 schools have contributed works which are on display at the multi-purpose unit at Scone High School. The idea was to present a true cross-section of art from the community, and to that end, many parents have also contributed works. Organisers estimate several hundred school children will view the paintings, drawings, mobiles, ceramics and pieces of sculpture on display. The exhibition will remain at Scone until early next week. The administration of Muswellbrook Hospital set out to deinstitutionalise its maternity ward with the $50,000 grant, and today their efforts went on public display. Apart from painting and carpeting, the ward now boasts some motel-style accommodation for couples who've travelled long distances to reach the hospital. The lounge area has also been redecorated, a modern kitchen installed, and each room given a bright new look. By deinstitutionalising the ward, the administration hopes to make the section less like a hospital and more like home to the increasing number of women using the ward's facilities.
Country shows serve many a purpose, but most importantly they are a showcase for the products of the countryside which support rural communities, and the richness and the diversity of Singleton's farmlands were more than amply reflected in the beef cattle judging ring today.
10 breeds were represented in the lineup of over 200 head, and among them, some of the most highly praised and prized of their breed in the land. The judging for the Supreme Champion Beef Bull was an exciting tussle, with a large gallery of onlookers showing their appreciation of the cattle by their undivided attentiveness. Emerging victorious was this 1,100 kilogram monster, the Simmental Cancillaire Lucien, who also celebrated his third birthday today. Bred and exhibited by Bill Armand of Jerry's Plains, Lucien showed outstanding growth for age, scale and muscling, and none of the rigours of a 17-hour truck trip back from the Melbourne Royal Show last week, where he was judged the best Australia has to offer.
The win in Melbourne was a tremendous thrill, it really was. We thought we'd do reasonably well, but to get right up on top in the second biggest showing of Simmentals in Australasia, it was a tremendous.
And his future, no doubt there's some cows that'd love to meet him.
Yes, I would say so. That's his future, and the immediate future will be that for sure.
Shortly after the conclusion of the beef judging, Lucien headed a grand parade lineup of beef cattle and horses of all shapes, sizes and colours that clearly was a joy to behold. The show was officially opened then by the chairman of the board of directors of NBN Limited, Mr. John Peshar, who praised not only the quality of the exhibits but also the energy of the show committee and the support of the district in putting such a magnificent rural exhibition together.